First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
That's right. Brother Mike, you on the line.
And yo, what up, OG?
That's what we're going to do tonight, right, is try to save the music.
Oh, no doubt, man.
All right. Well, you know, we're going to get to music, tones, and the sounds of healing. And, of course, we're going to be dealing with conscious music, as well as also breaking down how sound has a healing effect upon the body. Now, when we get into the metaphysics of it, or better yet, the lesson, you know, if you go to the 120 of the Nation of Gods on Earth, it speaks about that thought travels 24 billion miles per second. Light travels 186,000 miles per second, and sound travels 1,120 feet per second. So sound is slowed down light. Light is slowed down thought. So, of course, sound comes to be able to form geometrical shape or objects or patterns. So, this is seen throughout nature. You know, if you take some sand or magnetic particles and make a sound, it actually goes into a geometrical shape. So, healing comes in many ways, and basically it's up to each and every one of us to put together the right formula for the proper healing factor. The healing codes are different for each and every one of us. So, like an example, in Qigong, Tai Chi, which is Taoism, and various yogas and different other healing modalities, there's various sounds of healing that activates the seven major endocrine glands called the chakras. We'll get into all of this tonight, as well as also we're going to have some guests on if they call on in. Matter of fact, we're going to go to one of the guests right now. Let's see. Peace.
Hello, good night.
Good night.
Peace. I just want to inquire, what time will the interview be conducted tonight?
You can bring it on at 9 if you want to.
Oh. That is great. Thank you so much.
All right.
We surely will be listening as you speak, and hope to interview her later. Thank you so much.
All right. We're getting ready to bring her on in at 9. Y'all have something special tonight. There's going to be our special guest, and we're going to be dealing with the science of healing, not just the tones or the sounds or the music, but also dealing with the science of detoxifying, cleansing out herbology and colonics. So stay tuned for her, for the sister to come on and do her interview at 9 o'clock. All right. Now,
after this show?
Not yet. Well, he's going to be doing this show. All right. So we're going to go 2 hours, maybe a little bit more over tonight. But right now, for the next hour or so, we're going to do our thing, Brother Mike, and lift the audience up with some conscious info and music. You know, I know I got influence. I was 11 years old, and I was on a school bus, fourth grade. And a sister, and her brother was telling me about, Rapper's Delight, and Rapper's Delight was out during that time period, I was like, yo, it was something that I never even heard before, but I was just into it, and that Rapper's Delight album, But, I mean, I heard rap a little bit right before that from the, that was the Sugar Hill Gang, but it was just not them. It was the Fatback Band. They did a little something, that caught my attention. But when Rapper's Delight came, that really put me into it. So I'm 11. I started writing rhymes at that time period, So that's the reason why when cats hear my rhymes, they be like, yo, son, it's fire.
But Return of the Ancient One.
Right, that's because I've been rhyming for a long time, even though it's a hobby, and I haven't made no official, quote-unquote, my, I Stuff Lord and Master album yet, we definitely going to do that, and you already know you on when we get to that.
I would love to be featured on that. That would be
Oh, yeah, it ain't going to be, there's no doubt about it. You're going to be featured all right. Matter of fact, we get ready to feature you right now. So, audience, just hold on to your seat because this is my man, Brother Mike, and you get ready to hear his joint. And if you haven't heard it, you will hear something real tight, conscious, and that's what we're talking about tonight is conscious music. And that's what we want to hear. Is conscious music. We're tired of the nonsense that's on the radios. Songs played over and over again. Same five artists is played over and over again. The shit is just inundated with these particular artists. How many times can I hear Kanye West, Jay-Z, Nicki Minaj, Drake?
Little Wayne.
Exactly. How many times can we hear these same five people over and over again, the shit got so bad, at least it used to be 20 songs, now it should be down to 5 songs, or 5 artists
exactly.
Entertainment, which they put on constant rotation, and the people are going out buying this nonsense and thinking that this is real hip-hop or rap. Well, you know what, we got something special coming up soon. We're going to have Brother Black Dot on in July, so he's going to break down. The structure of hip hop, and what's really going on, we're gonna have quite a few. Matter of fact, we're gonna have Brother Phil Valentine, Dr. Phil Valentine on too in July. So y'all better keep listening and coming with some good stuff. But we're gonna get to Brother Mike's, Mike, what is your stage name, bro? We can't just have Mike Pratt. What we gonna have?
Well, it was called MAP.
MAP.
Called MAP because I was like, I called myself like the master of poetry,
Got you. All right. We got the map. He's gonna give you direction. Yeah, Brother Mike, you got mad skills. What you gonna be doing with that?
Thanks, yo. Yo, we gotta bring this music, this higher consciousness music, like Saw Rock is doing, like Black Dot is doing. We gotta bring this this is the shit that should be on the radio.
Exactly. What were some of your influences coming up into this rap, as they say, rap game, or should I say better yet, into hip hop? Because you call it black, or the shit hop.
Well, see, you grew up on the good shit, Aleem. I mean, you grew up when hip hop was just, you know, birthing itself. I grew up and everybody was listening to 50 Cent's Candy Shop in like fifth grade. Just all this lower vibration. I had to go through the lower vibration to get to the higher vibration. So the only things I would hear was like, you know, 50 Cent, Eminem, which Eminem is not bad or anything. That's just the stuff, you know, all the radio songs, because all the radio is what we had besides, if you had an MP3 player, you know, you could download more songs. But so I listened to a lot of, it started with 50 Cent and then moved to sort of Eminem. And then after a while, when I started really getting into hip hop, you know, Tupac, B.I.G., Rakim, Nas was always one of my favorite MCs.
So you had to take it back.
Yeah.
In order to get the appreciation for hip hop.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
I grew up on that whole lower vibration shit. I mean, it's fifth grade, right? Still like young minds, and they're singing a song about, you know, candy shop. You know, it's not a good vibration for the youth, man.
Right. Now,
you know
what
I mean?
Made you now what made you go into the conscious informational rap, you know? I mean, not, you know, many young, you know, cats today, you know, want to hear conscious music, you know. So what, you know, what was your influence towards going there? And be showing the audience the dichotomy between generations as far as the music is concerned. That which I grew up, like you said, and now that which that you grew up on, and, you know, showing that generation, which is 20 years, that 20-year gap of, you know, a change, you know, in hip-hop. You know, being that hip hop is only about 40 years old, you know,
yeah,
but it's only two generations or two decades. I mean, four decades, you know, but two generations, you know. And I grew up in the first generation of it, and you grew up in the second generation. So, you know, we're trying to get the audience dichotomy of the difference, you know, of because even in early rap, I mean, it was basically braggadocious what a brother wants and, you know, what he has, you know. Or what a that's fly, you know, and
all
of that type of stuff, you know. I got a Mercedes Benz, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to scroll around and show it to all my friends, you know. Right, but even then with the braggadocious, we knew that, yo, these cats was playing out something, you know, a fantasy, you know. You know, because we knew that they obviously was not making money at that time, like, you know, to that extent. But now we have cats who's making millions and billions, such as Puffy and Jay-Z, who, I mean, you know, look at Puffy. This nigga can't, you know, keep a damn group to save his fucking life. You know, honestly. You know, I mean.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Right.
And I mean, Puffy.
Yeah, check this out. But, yes, he's getting ready to be one of the first black billionaires in hip-hop.
Whoa.
You know, along with Jay-Z. You know, so, you know, you have to think how these cats are getting to these levels, you know, yet not doing much in regard to, you know, because Jay-Z, I don't care how many albums he sell, 1-2 million albums, 3 million albums, I mean, that's not enough in order, you know, over a span of time, such as, you know, 15 years, You know,
right.
Even though he's been in the game for like 20 years, you know, it's still not enough in order for him to become a billionaire. So, you know, there's other things that these people are doing, you know, these individuals are doing.
Yeah.
And Puffy, we have to question what he's doing because I know he has the, you know, the cologne, the, you know, the liquor.
Yeah, headphones.
As well, right, as well as also the Sean John clothes line. You know, he still has those things, but, I mean, come on. You know, I don't really see that many people wearing Sean John any longer. You know what I'm saying? So where's this cat making enough money in order to become a one of the so-called first black billionaires in hip-hop? And he can't keep a group. You know what I'm saying? I mean, every group that you can think of has left him, except for these two girls called Dirty Money and another guy that he got on Bad Boy right now that he had a little song that's popping on the radio. You know what I'm saying? But other than that, you know, it's amazing to me.
Yeah, it is. Well, I don't know. I question how conscious they are. I question the vibration
and the crazy
that they
part
are.
Is both of them study the God information. Both of them was once down with the God's nerves. You know?
Mm.
Yeah.
Wow, yeah. Well, Jay-Z, I mean, Jay-Z is definitely was conscious because he was a Nubian, right?
Exactly.
And he was with the he used to do that little fast rap thing where, you know, it was like him and I believe it was Jazz and
right. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah,
Jazz
exactly.
Up. Yep, exactly. Uh-huh.
And I mean So Jazzo
told us years ago that this cat sold him out, basically. You know, he put Jay-Z on, you know, and Jay-Z left him, you know what I'm saying, and, you know, and just left dude, you know. So, I mean.
Yeah, and he said in a video, I forgot what it was, I think it's I Can't Get With That. I gotta make it thick, never miss, so I hit him like this. And he said, Rockefeller, never sell her out. I don't know if you remember that joint.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, exactly, and that one. It's just like, it's crazy to, you know, he said he'd never sell out, but
right.
I don't know, maybe he just got so popular, you know, he went pop, you know, so. But.
Well, I mean, Nas broke down how he gained his popularity in the Ether song.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you go back and listen to that, then you have really that science.
Yeah, exactly. And Black Dot, he decoded that whole Ether thing and went into that. I mean.
Right, right. No doubt about it.
But I would is that all right if I expand a little bit on my journey into hip hop?
Oh yeah.
All right. So you know, it started with the 50 Cent, the Eminem, that whole shit. And when I went to school, I mean it wasn't like, you know, I mean it was a good school, for the most part. But you had a good school with a lot of people rocking the lower vibration. So not that the fact that it was ghetto, just the mentality of the young ones was crazy from, you know, I mean, all, you know, the different kids, you know, listening to the music. So when I started out, you know, listening to the 50 Cent, the Eminems, I was like, I used to love that, you know, or thought that I loved that, you know, when Ludacris came out with that song, you know, Get Back, you know, there was this, you know, I was a young kid, so I just, you know, I loved it all. But as, you know, I grew older, got into, in middle school, that lower vibration was growing strong. I mean, you had the Pussycat Dolls. All the girls were dancing and doing that Pussycat Doll dance, and just all these different groups, right? And the vibration was a lower vibration, especially when I got into middle school. By the time I got into high school, that shit went to a whole different level. I mean, so, anyways, when I was in high school, we used to have, this is when I really started to MC. We'd have, like, little battles and things like that. You know, somebody would come up and try to, like, embarrass you, and I would get them every time, except for this one little, black dude, and he was like, you know, he said some stupid shit like, "I got your mom on YouTube" or something like that, and he beat me. But anyways, I was looking for the more technical part of hip-hop, right? So I wanted actual lyricism. I wanted, you know, that actual hip-hop. So I beat some dudes, and, you know, they'd be mad at me, and some of them would just have a problem with the fact that I beat them. But, you know, I mean, it's hip-hop. But anyways, after I got out of school, I didn't drop out. I got homeschooled after that because my high school was like a little version of the ghetto, because it was just the way that the mentality of the people were, and the vibration and the violence, it was shit I didn't want to take, you know what I mean? I needed to get into a more positive place. So I went home school. Basically, in my journey, this is when all that conspiracy and Illuminati, Freemason stuff started to come out. And so as I got better, you know, I kept practicing day after day, you know, MCing. You know, I wanted to be an MC. I always wanted to be an MC. But, you know, there was all these different, you know, I mean, I was in the Eminem, you know, for, you know, the longest time, and Nas. And so I really wanted to MC. And basically what happened was I saw that people started getting scared of all this Illuminati shit. So I basically tried to use it because nobody was getting my attention. I tried to use it to my advantage as in the sense of doing things to shock people in that kind of way. And, you know, there was so many, Christians and different people. It was an awesome opportunity to shock people, you know, because people were getting so caught up in stories and, like, selling the soul to the devil and stuff like that. It was a perfect opportunity to, like, shock some people or get a reaction. So I did that for a while, and it worked, but it wasn't really me, and I was still evolving in the sense, because the stuff that I was looking at was more, it was basically like wicked lyrics, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
Something
like, what you think about that cannabis battle? Have you seen it?
What was it?
Cannabis. He's going against cannabis. He's going against another cat. This is on all over YouTube, just like about a week or two ago. Did you ever check that out? Did you see that?
No, I didn't check that out. I do. I have listened to a lot of cannabis. I know a friend that knows him that did a song with him. This is a white boy up in Chicago, I think. I mean, cannabis is ill. I mean, lyrically, man. Dude said.
On this particular battle, he got stomped, you know, and it's something to see, because a lot of cats lost faith that they definitely hear conscious music after that, you know what I'm saying? Because the guy wasn't even spitting anything conscious. It was just like a straight battle, you know, and it's just something to see. You know, I definitely want to go to that.
Yeah, that's actually how Eminem beat Cannabis, because Eminem's fans don't really care about conscious rap, and Cannabis was, like, you know, super high-conscious hip-hop. And that's how they say he won, is because Eminem doesn't do that.
Right.
But anyway, so I was going to say, so I started getting into all these different things. It started changing with religions because, you know, I grew up Christian. I had that kind of forced to grow up being a Christian, you know, going to church and all that. Never really felt it was right for me. And so I started exploring all these different, you know, things, philosophies, you know, and I started incorporating that into my hip-hop. So whatever I learned about, you know, Aleister Crowley, or I learned, and this was before I got into the metaphysics and the melanin and all that. This was way before. This is the awakening, you know what I mean?
Right.
And so all this different shit, and I got tired because I was this good MC and stuff like that, right? And, I mean, I learned some martial arts, but I never really liked to fight people, you know, and there'd be some cats that, you know, would want to. I don't know if they were jealous or whatever it was. So I would use this, you know, my lyrical weapons, you know, to protect me, keep me safe, that type of thing. But as, you know, I went through all these different philosophies, metaphysics, started growing. It was a great journey. Met a lot of people, like I told, like I said. But one day I came across Aleem, doctor, right? It was this doctor, and it was with this lady. I didn't know who it was. Said it was Miss Blue. And then was this guy named Aleem Elbey, and he was speaking on the holy orgasm or something like this. I was like, I got to check this shit out, you know. And then I would definitely say you, Aleem, definitely inspired me in the higher consciousness hip-hop as far as taking it to the highest level that I can take it. But as in from my journey, all that this led to was back to ancient Kemet, the Egyptians. This is where it all led to. And so that's basically, you know, a good part of my journey into, it was a long transformation alchemy type of process to get to be, you know, this higher level, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
I wish it was quicker.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the key of putting out information, is to uplift and bring people into some real consciousness, because what's going on right now is BS, you know. And, you know, we just finished playing your joint, and I'm getting ready to play Mars, which is Burning Gates, and you're going to hear me spit some fire at the end here. This is what Mike was talking about with me spitting my verse at the end. But here it is right here. Give me some feedback.
Yeah. South Shaolin. The classified elements. We here now. To all you Fruit Loop. Colored candy, white peanut butter and jelly. Coon ass niggas. You best duck and rubber cover. Yeah. 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 Yo, yo, into the temple gates, cross the fiery lakes, for witness to tortured souls, and plant upon burning stakes, ascend the cherubims, raising hell to reach heaven gates, firebombing cathedrals when I switch my cross to state, regards the animal, from animal back to regards. I'm throwing these jewels like WD Parade to raise a nation that's indispensable, indivisible, based on principle, relate to digital outputs to outlooks, temperatures rising as the sun of righteousness gives spiritual guidance in the lion's den. The phoenix arises, spitting bars for Mars to the belt of Orion with the eye to Hootie. These faggot devils can't fool me. The phallus gave porn and digesting the pig's booty. The sin is the wickedness, lost in the wilderness. We're never at here to this. Go ahead and slit your wrist. The black guard exists. What devils try to exit, living in planet crisis until destroyed by ISIS. In a pit of demons, I'm ancient Kemet dreaming, converting satanic hordes with the beta semen. Sword swinging, decapitator, parable addicted, crystal wand mystic, keeping global drinks when I'm lifted. I'm Melchizedek, moving through 50 states. Early trespassers with the gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I emanate golden rays above my head's a figure eight. I'm Melchizedek, moving through 50 states. Early trespassers with the gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I emanate golden rays above my head's a figure eight. In the devil's head, severed on a dinner plate. Before the throne of God, all devils will meet the fate. Below the mason dick, surrounds the future great. Imperial, ferial, sounds the trumpets through the stereo. Murders of mics, that's why I scratch off the cereal. Reverse creation, send you back to some minerals. South Shaolin, double MC is the abbot. More rich be the nation. Black man's land, we gotta have it. Restore the throne, eradicate the savage. When disaster strikes, actual facts you can't manage. A fool's on deck, sink ships like Titanic. Spread of fear across the land, causing unjustified panic. Amongst the brain dead zombies, grab the Spencer bandits while these wicked overseers collect residuals in a hammock. Corporate fruits forever remain rancid, poisoning to the mind, afflicted subconscious, damn it. I'm Melchizedek, moving through 50 states. Early transmittance with the gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I emanate golden rays above my head's a figure eight. I'm Melchizedek, moving through 50 states. Early transmittance with the gods I relate. Mental alchemists, watch love conquer hate. I emanate golden rays above my head's a figure eight. Return of the ancient one, the Moorish Naga, the dragon rider, or breathing fire, generator, operator, destroyer, a self, lord and master, instructor, a Kama Sutra, practicing Tantra, a Kriya Yoga, a Kutalini, the resurrector, Shishuna, the eater, Pingala, awaken the seven chakra, to come the avatar, Muhammad the conqueror, putting swords to your jugular, send you to the ether, the water, air, fire, bender, the earth ruler, usher in the new era. In the saga, eyes filled with terror, eerie sounds of horror, reflection cracked mirrors, minds made feeble, dreams crumble, the curse tremble, thieves in the temple, raise the mental, beyond the four devils, you whack motherfuckers, you know what I'm saying, or you got them cool niggas out there, you know what I'm saying, yo, it's time to put that fucking rope around them goddamn throats, you know what I'm saying, cause you didn't all this goddamn hip-hop, that's why hip-hop dead, motherfuckers.
Yeah,
cool niggas, and that's, and if you was offended by that, then you must be the motherfucker I was talking to, right? But anyway, that was me rhyming on the end there, talking much shit and much enlightenment, all right? So
that's one of my favorite joints. That's one of my favorite joints.
All right, I'll be off the top.
I never heard somebody rhyme like that before.
Oh, you did? You talking about the flow?
Yeah.
See, that's what I'm saying. That's what happens after you got plenty of years of experience of this. I mean, I got rhymed 20 years ago. That sounded like, just like, Killer Priest right now, you know, or Killer Army right now, or Sons of Man right now. You know, and I wrote this 20 years ago off of my influences, who was KRS-One and Poor Righteous Teachers, X-Clan, as well as also Rakim.
Rakim,
the God.
Oh, but that sounded better than Rakim. I mean, no disrespect, but I mean, with the flow, man.
Yeah, well, that's where hip-hop's supposed to be going. See, that was the point of me doing that song, was to take hip-hop to where it's supposed to be at right now. Not to where it is, you know, which is, as we say, shit hop or the bastardized child of hip hop, which is rap. you know, we're not rappers, we're MCs, and there is a difference, you know, because these ones are the masters of ceremonies. That's where MC comes from. You know, a rapper, shit, I put a W on that shit, and, you know, you can rap presents, you know, during Christmas time. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, it don't really get any real significance as far as that is concerned, you know. But we all wanted to be MCs, and that was the science then, and that's the science now. You know, and we had Blacked Out on. Huh?
I was going to say, what did you think of the flow and the rhythm on my joint?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that was tight, too. You know, that's what I'm talking about. That's why I asked you who did the production, you know. The production was tight. The information was tight. I mean, that's what I'm talking about. That's where hip-hop's supposed to be at right now. You know what I'm saying? It's about uplifting, you know what I'm saying, about personifying the information now. You know, not still being objective and looking at women objectively or looking at cars objectively or looking at bling objectively. You know, they got everything objective, you know, instead of being internal. You know, being internalized. You know, you just heard me, Rom. I just finished talking about the Kundalini, you know, the seven chakras, the five elements, you know, the four devils, you know, our self, Lord and Master, you know, return of the ancient one. I mean, all of that is in it, you know. So I give you a synopsis of the information in this particular age, known as the New Age, even though, you know, what you often hear as the New Age philosophy is bullshit. But we're taking it to a whole other level in that song, and that's the point, you know.
Wait,
so,
were you saying the New Age philosophy was bullshit?
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
Right. The New Age information is BS. You know, a lot of it, you're talking about the Palladians and all these extraterrestrials coming down, you know, and the thing is...
Oh, okay, I see what you mean.
And right, which once again is something objective. I mean, it's no different than, you know, me waiting for white Jesus to come out the sky, you know, in order to save me. You know, it's the same philosophy. If I'm waiting for a UFO, if I'm waiting for white Jesus, you know, both has a external philosophy in which that is.
But there are beings in
but they can't wipe my ass for me. So I don't care where they at, and yes, they do exist, but I mean, I'm gonna call one down to wipe my ass? No. I'm going to raise myself up, you know, because right above the crack of my ass is my Kundalini, and I'm gonna become the greatest spiritual being I can become so I can actually communicate with them. Because if they have to come down to a third dimension, then they come into a cesspool. And I don't know if I need to get with them or not, because they come in here.
Right.
If it's anything, we need to raise up to where they at, you know, if they're on a higher plane of consciousness. I don't want UFOs or extraterrestrials to come into this third dimension, you know what I'm saying? Because I know the mentality of the third dimensional beings in which that is here on this planet. So they come in here, I mean...
And they probably wouldn't appreciate that.
Right. Would the mentality be too much different?
Yeah, definitely.
You see? So I don't think the mentality would be too much different, you know, for beings coming to this third-dimensional apparent reality, because they would be dealing with the same thing that we're dealing with. You know?
Exactly.
Greed, lust, envy, and jealousy. Food, clothing, and shelter, you know what I'm saying? You know, just all of these things. They have to be dealing with the same things that we're dealing with, you know? So why come here if you're on a higher dimension? You know, why not wait the planet graduate? Because that's actually what it's doing. The planet is actually spiraling through in a corkscrew way, spiraling through the galaxy, Milky Way galaxy, and we're graduating. We're moving through the various armbands of the Milky Way, or what is called the photon belt, the dark rift, and then also into the inner armband of the photon belt from the third, fourth, and eventually into the fifth dimension.
So
these beings are not coming down to the planet per se, not the higher ones, you know. But the planet is graduating. So that's
definitely.
And we're moving through there. We're moving through their home. You know what I'm saying? As we are moving, you know, and graduating, we're moving through their home. So they're seeing what is this phenomenon in which that is taking place. you know. But they don't want to come to no third dimension. That's why we got to raise this planet up to a fifth dimensional state, which deals with energy. You know what I'm saying? Fourth dimension deals with depth, which is time and space. Third dimension deals with length, width, and height. You know, you don't
want to. The fifth deals with energy, right?
Right. It deals with energy. So this is the reason why we're going into this music and sound tones and sound vibrations and frequencies tonight, is because it's energy, and that's what we're dealing with. You know?
Exactly. I was gonna share if anybody wanted to hear about my Qigong experience.
Oh yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so it was a four day retreat seminar type thing. Had the guy up there, was from Florida. His name was Jeff Frymack, and he was a raw foodist, master Qigong teacher. He studied with many masters. I'm not going to compare him to Sunyata Saraswati, because I'm pretty sure he's not there, and that's not, you know, but he was, you know, he definitely expounded on a lot of the information. So when I went there, it was like conscious community right everywhere. I mean, everybody was on that frequency. There was no fear there. There was no, it was all love there. All it was love there. And there was qi going everywhere before. Because, you know, when I was practicing qigong, I was practicing, you know, that Art of Qigong book that you recommended, I think, last year sometime, right?
Right.
I forgot, I think it was Wong View Kit.
Right.
That was the one I was practicing. And so I got it, but, you know, it was from a book. So it was good information, but it's hard to, you know, practice that unless you're looking at the book constantly just to make sure, you know, you got the right form and everything. So when I went there, it was a complete, I thought it'd just be about Qigong. It was complete, they completely opened the spiritual gateway for any form of spirituality there. And when we were doing the Qigong, guy passed me the microphone. After we had done the Warrior's Breath the first time, he was like, "So what did you feel?" I was like,
"Right, now what is the warrior, breath?"
Now the Warrior's Breath is when you're kind of laying down, but you're laying on, you're using your elbows to lift you up, right? And then you're vigorously breathing in through the nose and out through the mouth. And you do that about 150 times.
Okay, so rapid breathing. Got you.
Right.
Got
so
you.
He passed me the microphone. They got this on video. He passed me the microphone. And I said, he said, "So what did you feel?" I was like, "Well, man, I felt like a Dragon Ball Z character."
Right.
And, you know, just so, I mean, that and just what we did with the holding hands and sending energy, you know, all throughout various parts of the planet. Then we learned one. It was almost like, because, I mean, honestly, with chi itself, what opened me to that was Dragon Ball. So I got to give credit to Dragon Ball, you know. That's where the whole chi and energy and all that, that's where that opened up.
So that was a good thing that, you know, during the 90s and early 2000s, when Dragon Ball, GT, all of that was going on, you know. Because,
exactly.
It did give y'all the chance in order to open up, you know, to this information that we already was, you know, into in the late 80s. So, you know, we definitely got to give it up for that. And you even hear me, you know, break down the Avatar and Dragon Ball Z information in that song that we just did called Burning Gates by Classified Elements, which I am a member of. So, you know, we definitely understand that.
All right, can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Loud and clear.
All right.
Yeah.
Peace and blessings. Yeah. Peace and blessings.
Yes, what you got for us today?
Oh, man. yeah, quite a bit. Where you want to start at? I see you was talking about, you know, subject matter has pretty much been like the vibrations in the music in reference
right.
to
right.
what has been done to, like, hip-hop and things like that. My focal point in reference to vibrations deals with its effect, you know, on our youth and our communities, and music being one of the catalysts. When we get into talking about how the music is affecting us, you know, we have to remember that, you know, they sped up the vibrations of music, so much so that now the music that we listen to really is driving us insane. If you think about historically, in our communities, when we used to have parties, the parties had a certain vibration to them. You know, they were like house parties. You know, everybody came to the parties. You dressed up, or if it was themed or whatever like that, but you came. And the purpose of coming to the party was to dance and to, like, socialize. You know, we were showing that people came and showed off their new dances. They came and showed off their new clothes, you know, but it was more of a community, tribal-type gathering. Now,
right.
when we think of party, we think of, you know, all of the sexual related activity that takes place. We think of drinking. You know, you can't have a party without drinking and drugs now. It's like, it's not, you know,
exactly.
a party ain't a party unless you got some kind of alcoholic beverages or some kind of intoxicant or drug or something like that. So that shows that
exactly.
something has happened in reference to the progression of us as a people. So in all of the information that we've acquired and all of the quote-unquote progress that we've made since the days of our oppression and subjugation, it seems as though we've gone further backwards than we've gone come forward. So when we pay, when we listen to these to our music, we have to pay attention not just to the lyrics, not just to the to the message that's being presented. We also have to listen to the instrumentalization that deals with it. There are certain positive songs that came out back in the 90s that the only reason that they let those songs out was because they had certain tones in them. There was a song, one of my classic jams, you know, was Arrest the President by Intelligent Hoodlum, Tragedy.
That's right, Tragedy.
And
yeah.
But the song was like extremely politically charged. You
yeah.
know what I'm saying? It was like, man, and I used to ask, like, man, how did that song get across? But as I got older and I would go back and listen to it, because, my children, I impress upon them the importance of good music. So, you know, my children listen to music back from the 40s and the 50s, and, you know, my son is like, all he cares about is old school hip-hop, you know what I'm saying? You would think he was born in the 70s, you know, so when I'm explaining that to them, to go back and listen to the music, and I listened to that song, Rest the President, and I realized the reason they let that song come through was because there was a high-pitched siren going on in the back of that song, and if you listen to it, that siren was doing damage while the message was being presented. And I'm like, oh, they real deep in how they do that. So we have to be careful of the tone and the tonal vibrations that come through the instruments. If you notice now, you can go and you can make a whole album and not have one single musical instrument. You know,
yep.
you can
yeah.
everything is on
yeah.
a, you know what I'm saying? And people, we don't think that, you know, so we call ourselves musicians and we call ourselves artists and things like that. You
yeah.
know, and we may not even play an instrument. You know, we may not even
but
play
it,
piano or play. So the
right,
question was
been
that
synthesized.
It's synthesized. So synthesized music means what? It means it's not authentic. It's not an item striking another item, creating a natural vibration in nature. So what's happened is they've taken and they've mimicked that sound. Take the 808 kick. The 808 kick was created specifically, and it was targeted at the young community because the 808 kick is a combination of a shotgun blast and a bass drum and an explosion. So when you hear the 808 kick, you're like, yo, we got that bass. But it's literally tearing up your kundalini. It's tearing your chakras up, you know. So when you travel up that kundalini up your spine through your chakra energy seats, there are things that are keeping us from being balanced. So when we start talking about our health, we start talking about our mental status, we start talking about, you know, even just our standings within our communities, all of that is a direct effect of how vibrations have affected us negatively. So now, we listening to all of this music, and the music has been affected. Then we're eating all this food, and the food has been processed, so it's been affected. You know what I'm saying? So now we're thinking all these thoughts, and our thoughts have been influenced and affected, you know, and so on and so forth. So now we actually are an aberration of what we originally were as a people, as a human
exactly.
being. We can't even consider ourselves a human being because we've become, so, you know, if the animals look at us like, man, what the heck is that? You know what I'm saying? The conservationists, the naturalists, all of these people are trying to, you know, push a movement to help save the planet Earth. You know, we have to realize what we've done. The scientists have said, and they have a report about this, you know, I have the actual report where they wrote it at. They said that the frequency that they used when they created cell phones was the worst possible frequency that they could have picked for humans. They say when you have a Bluetooth device in your ear when you're driving, they say any device, anything that is distracting you from driving or from your current purpose, you know, it has an adverse effect on your brain waves. So they say these things, these devices are causing brain cancer and so on and so forth. So the question is, how can something like a phone cause brain cancer? It's all about vibrations. So now we want to jump into the human being, the human body, and the fact that some say we vibrate at a frequency of about 207 megahertz. You know, some deal with megahertz, some deal with just general hertz. Some say the body, a normal brain, vibrates between, 48 and 58 hertz. They say a genius brain is like 58 to 65, you know. So each organ in your body has a frequency that they vibrate at. This is the thing that we're not taught. We don't take these into consideration when we're doing things like taking care of our health. When you eat food, people say, well, I'm going to start eating healthy. You shouldn't eat healthy. You should eat vibrationally. And what that means is anybody can go and pick up a carrot, you know, pick up some lettuce, you know, eat a salad and so on and so forth. We'll say, I'm going to be a vegan or I'm going to be a vegetarian. That's right. Easy to do or easy to say, as not as easy to do. But if you're not eating vibrationally, it really doesn't matter. You know, now what I mean by that is any processed food that we eat has no vibration. And we being beings of high vibrations of different frequencies, we need nourishment that's going to feed those vibrations. So if we're not eating food that has vibrations, then we're going and we're exposing ourselves to all of these lower vibrations. And when I mean lower vibrations, I don't mean low frequencies. I mean low vibrations, things that make you vibrate slower. If your vibrational rate drops below, 35, that's when you start. I'm sorry, not 35. If it drops below, I want to say 42, that's when you start getting sick. If your vibrational
right.
frequency drops to like 35, that's how you catch cancer. Death, it vibrates at 25.
Right.
You know, so when you've passed away, you're still vibrating, but the vibration of death is 25 and under. So, if we live in a society that keeps us vibrating normally between the ranges of like 40 and 50, then we live in an environment that promotes sickness. So if we're going to do something to change that, we have to create an environment that promotes a higher vibration. Now, love vibrates at a frequency of 500 megahertz.
Is it 528?
If you want to get specific, it's between 500 and 530.
Oh,
now,
okay.
Because now, the human vibrates at 200 and 210 between that frequency. So we're not even vibrating at a frequency where we can even understand what love is. Peace vibrates between 700 and 720. So we're talking a lot of that's why the biggest problem that we have as humans is that we won't shut up. I wrote a book called, and excuse my friend, Shut the Fuck Up. And the purpose of the book was to discuss the difference between having a license to talk and having the right to talk. As humans, in order to get a license to talk, all you have to do is learn something, read a book, experience something, go somewhere. You know, any experience in your life that increases your knowledge base gives you a license to talk. that doesn't necessarily give you the right to talk. The right to talk is earned from your application of the things that you learn and your balancement and harmony and entombment with nature around you. Because there is little of that, we always talk out of term and we're always talking. But if you take a bottle of water and you put a thought into that water and you say, well, I'm going to put peace and love and harmony on this into this water, and then you freeze that water overnight and you take another bottle of water and you think hate and sickness and death and disease, and you put that frequency on that water and you freeze that, and then when you take each, and the next day you take a microscope and you magnify those water molecules, the water with the positive vibrations will look like a beautiful snowflake. And the water with the negative vibration will look like a virus, which means that our thoughts have an effect both locally and in an extended distance. So if your thoughts can affect water and the body, the human body is 90% water, what are our thoughts doing to our bodies? So we literally are walking around as viruses on the planet Earth, constantly affecting ourselves, constantly affecting each other, and every, you know, it's so much that's been put together that the ultimate solution is to create an enclosed place that keeps all that from taking place. If we can create an enclosed garden, an enclosed place, and not allow any of those adverse vibrations within that environment, we can do a lot to begin to change the energy of the planet. Now, if we start with music, you know, in general, this is what we do. We have become, as a human race, we've become, symptom, we become symptom treaters, right? We realize that there's a problem, so we start treating the symptoms, as opposed to going back and finding the origin, the cause, and correcting that origin and cause so that the next wave, the next generation of us don't have to go through that. So when we were in the 70s, there was a symptom that was going through our communities. So what they did was they added something to make the symptoms seem like they went away, which created another problem. So in the 80s, we had another problem, and so on and so forth, all the way up to now in the 2000s. If we look at our communities are nothing like they were in the 70s or in the 80s. A lot of us live in houses, and we don't even know our next-door neighbors. We live in communities when we won't let our children go outside because we don't know the mindset of people in the community. We don't know if there's registered sex offenders in the community. We don't know if there are, you know, mass murderers in the community. We don't know if there are children who are involved in drugs and gang acts. We don't know because we don't know our community. And that was done purposely. It was done purposely because one of the last strongholds that we had as humans was our communal nature. And it was that communal nature that gave us the power of unity. And by giving us the power of unity, we are able to come together and take a simple concept, and because a number of us are vibrating on that same vibration with that concept, we give that concept that much more power. Perfect example. 2,000 years ago, they came up with a concept about a man who died, came, was born, immaculately conceived, lived and died for our sins, and this concept was promoted historically for 2,000 years, and now millions of people around the world have given it power. So, of course, you can go down to certain places, and you every now and then you hear a news report on TV talking about there was a miracle at a church, and one of the statues of the Mother, Holy Mother Mary, was crying blood, and, you know, or there was people was getting healed when they were getting bathed in this holy water that was, you know, and it's all these different things because we, as the powerful beings that we are, have the ability to give power vibrationally to anything around us. Take a rock and put it in your house and have every member of your family say something to that rock, the same thing every day to that rock, like, rock, you are the bomb. And everybody say that. After a certain point of time, that rock is going to start to vibrate with the power of the words that are being placed into it, and eventually that rock will have power. If you want that rock to protect your house, all you got to do is put a seine of protection on that rock and have everybody in the house do it over and over and over again. And when you leave, that rock will protect your house, not because the rock is powerful, but because you vibrationally charged it with power. So think about that. And as we're thinking about that concept of charging, think about how the music charges us. Think about how our parties now are so sexually charged and so alcohol and drug charged because the music is charging us like that. Why do you have 6-7-year-old girls dancing like strippers? Why do you have 7-9-year-old boys walking around literally not caring about human life, so much so that they'll go and they'll take another human's life? Because
yes,
we are being charged. The
right.
water in our body is being charged by the thoughts that are being promoted and broadcast by the music and the instrumentalization and the thoughts and energy and intentions behind it. So if we're going to do anything to save the next generation of our children, we're going to have to create a place where all that negative energy don't come. I'm not a religious man, but the story of Sodom and Gomorrah in the Bible is a perfect example, because when Lot and his family were told to leave, they said, don't look back, or you're going to get turned into a pillar of salt. So what must have been going on in that city must have been something that was off the chain for them not to be even able to look back.
Yeah.
So in this day and time, we are living in a modern-day Sodom and Gomorrah, if you think about it. Like they say, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. That literally has become the concept in all of our communities, because there is some debauchery going on in our community. You know,
our teenage
girls and boys and stuff, I mean, just have a conversation with them and their ideas about different things. I do youth counseling. I talk to teenagers and things. And when I talk to them, and I'm open with them. I'm like, okay, well, let's talk about whatever, you know. And when you start talking about love, you start talking about relationships, you start talking about, and they start, you know, pontificating as if they are. I mean, look, you ain't rolled the planet around the sun long enough to even understand what these principles are about. Don't tell me what love is. You can't tell me what love is. I was telling my children earlier, I said, you don't fall in love and get married and live happily ever after. No. You link up with someone who's vibrationally, y'all vibrationally were attracted to each other. Y'all have similar ideals about life. Y'all have similar concepts about certain things. Y'all establish a relationship, and in that relationship is where you develop the love. So when you see couples who've been together for 50, 60, 70, 80 years, and you're like, man, how were you able to stay together? It's because they didn't come together and fall in love with each other. They came together and they made it, because love is a vibration.
Right.
Their relationship vibrates.
Instead of falling, why not rise in love? So, you know, when you use the falling part, you would think of something going down. So,
something undesirable.
Right.
Who wants to fall into anything?
You're right.
But people say, well, I'm looking to be swept off my feet to fall. No, not really. Because if I came and I pushed you down the stairs and I said, did you want to fall down there? No. But if I helped you up the stairs, you know, like, you know, that's a more positive thing. And then when you think of falling, you also think of drop. And that's what happens to your vibrations. So we're not loving falling in love. We're falling in lust. And lust is one of the 16,000 disagreeable traits that we were given by the quote-unquote devil.
Mm.
We were given 99 agreeable traits by our ancestors, the creators of the universe, by whatever name we wish to call them. The evil one broke the circle and spat 16,000 disagreeable ones. That seems like an imbalance, doesn't it? But really, the all in 99 is one, and the 16,000 is one. The only difference is that if I take two vases, or vases, or however you pronounce them, and one is green and one is red, and the green represents the positive traits and the red represents the negative traits, and I take the green one and I shatter it and it breaks up into 99 pieces, and then I take the red one and shatter it and keep breaking it and then break it up into 16,000 pieces, it was still the same two vases. There's just more pieces of the red one to go around, which is why it's easier for us to think a negative thought. We have to put mental focus into thinking positive thoughts. We have to say, we're going to do something positive. But when it's negative, it jumps right out of us.
That's right.
So that's a program. Yep. That means that we were programmed a certain way. You know, and the bottom, you know, once when you get down to the bottom of it, the bottom line is the fact that because we don't share a tonal unity as community, as a nation, as a people, or whatever classification you want to call ourselves, because we don't share a tonal unity, we always engage with each other based on ego and intellect. And you can't build anything if you can't come together in what they say, in love and unity.
Well, wouldn't you say the conscious community does that pretty well, or at least, you know, attempts to?
The conscious community?
Yeah.
That is the primary focus of what they do in the conscious community. But there are so many distractions that are placed in the conscious community for them, because not only are they trying to make a better existence mentally, spiritually, and culturally for their people, they're also
right.
being watched by government organizations. They're also being attacked by their own people. You know what I'm saying? So it's so much happening. You know, so it's gotten to the point where the conscious community is almost just like another aspect of Western society, you know, because you have what they call the quote-unquote conscious community. So you people go into conscious community, and it's like most of the – I've been to conscious communities where people live it. It's their everyday life. And I've been to conscious communities where it's like a garb. It's like church. It's like every week or once a month or once a year, everybody dress up in their African clothes, and they come out, and they, yes, this is the conscious. This is what we do. But the rest of the year, you know, they working 9 to 5s, you know what I'm saying? Children in public school, you know, the whole nine yards. So it's not, it's more of a
right.
pseudo consciousness, you know. But
that's
again,
good.
It's because vibrations, they have to keep us distracted. They can't allow the human to reach his or her full potential. If we reach our full potential on earth, they have to tell us that the only thing that you can be is a good Christian. The only thing that you can be is a decent human being. And that's a lie. They know we can be much more than that. They know that we can become a perfected being on earth. It says it in their books. But they say, well, that's only for this person. Says who?
Right.
And because they control the language, and because they control the flow of information, because they control the vibrational content of everything. They control the media. They control, you know what I'm saying, they've gotten into the music industry. They've gotten into, you know, the schools. They've gotten into, you know, the cultural centers. They've gotten into everything. Like, look at our children right now. Our children, the average teenager doesn't respect culture. And I say that because if you take them someplace, or if you bring someone of a different culture into their community, the first thing that they're going to do is ridicule it because it's different than what they do, as if they have a culture. You know, the practice of niggerism is not a culture. You know what I'm saying? So this is what they've, you know what I'm saying, this is the legacy that has been left, and this is what our positioning in this is. We have a unique opportunity to reverse the vibrational destruction of our communities. We have that opportunity. The question is, will we shut up long enough to do it?
That's true.
Yeah, definitely true. Hold on, Dr. Kawan.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to bring another healer into the discussion.
Okay. No problem.
Greetings, 347, you're on the line.
Welcome, Dr. Bay. Thank you so much for allowing this interview. 4594, that's the number to pick up, please. 4594.
Area code 917?
Yes. Ms. Tracy Piper, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Welcome, Ms. Tracy Piper of the Piper Center for Internal Wellness, to the Dr. Bay Show, and thank you, Dr. Bay, for welcoming this interview.
And thank you.
I just wanted to, I was listening in to what you were saying, and I'm completely enlightened and just very proud to be on your show, just hearing your knowledge and meaning, I guess, speaking with someone who is on the same level. So I want to thank you for sharing what you just said. It's beautiful.
And
I think it was needed.
You know, we're going to continue on with the discussion, so everybody stay on the line, you know. And I guess, Deborah,
okay.
If you want to continue, you can.
Okay, thank you so much. Okay, Ms. Tracy Piper of the Piper Center for Internal Wellness, you are on a righteous and ever-changing path as a colon therapist, which entails helping many with digestive disorders, as well as various health-related disorders. Now, tell us, how did you emerge on this health and wellness journey?
Well, I actually started out with my grandmother, who was into herbs as a child, and would always give me, quote-unquote, some kind of bush to drink, and I thought she was, you know, not sane, but it helped me get myself together as a kid. I wanted to become a doctor, and unfortunately, a friend of mine died from severe constipation. He was actually a radio jockey, and he was 38 years old, and his colon burst on him from not going to the bathroom the way he was supposed to be going. He was going to the bathroom once a day, but apparently it wasn't enough for his system, and his colon burst on him, and he passed away.
I'm so sorry to hear about that, but I'm happy that from that, you know, along the way, you know, you were able to learn more about digestive health and disorders and help a lot of people on your journey, on your path.
Yes.
Now, what
I'm
services
happy about
does
that.
Yes, definitely, definitely. Sorry for your loss, but we're truly happy that you're here and helping others. Now, what services does your center provide?
We do massage, acupuncture, reflexology, colonics, air handling, foot detox, different body wraps, herbal body detox wraps, and infrared sauna about pulling heavy metals. A lot of different detox protocols for the liver and the gallbladder, for heavy metals, and the kidneys. We like to specialize on whole body, all systems of the body.
Excellent, excellent. Now, just to let everybody know very briefly, Ms. Tracy Piper of the Piper Center for Internal Wellness, she's located in New York City at 73 Spring Street, Suite 305, New York, New York, the Piper Center for Internal Wellness. Now, it is said that colonics cleanses the entire body. What actually takes place when one has a colonic?
Well, first, I use an FDA-approved machine, and all the equipment I use is disposable. And so the person, when they come in to see me, we do a full intake form, history of what's going on with them, and then I go over that with them, and then we start doing a massage. So I like to do a massage so I can get a feel of their system, move the stool around, move the gas, get a better idea of how they're feeling, if there's any tenderness or anything like that. And then I put them on their left side, the left side because the body drains on the left side, and then a disposable speculum is lubricated and inserted into an inch and a half into the colon. And water is going in and out of the system through for about a 40-45 minute session. And
now,
we do that, and I look
water,
and see how much gas comes out. Mm-hmm.
How much water is being
used,
you know,
at a time?
Pumped, used, exactly, utilized during the colonic.
It's about between 5 to 10, sometimes even 15 gallons of water, depending on how constipated someone is or how long they stay on the table.
Okay. Now, there are a lot of critics who might say that colonics might break down the organs of the body. It might, for example, some say you use it or you lose it. You know, if you happen to hook yourself up to a dialysis machine and it's doing the job of a kidney, the kidney organ might break down. Do you find that to be true, or any truth to that matter in regards to using colonics, and that your colon may be breaking down or not being as effective functioning because it's not being depended upon as much, because the colonic is actually might possibly do the job of the colon as in regards to removing the waste from the body?
Absolutely not, and I'll explain to you why.
Please
colonics
do.
Is mainly for building and strengthening, toning the colon, increasing the peristalsis. It's also the art skill of the therapist. So you have to make sure you ask a lot of questions to the therapist and make sure that they're very qualified and know what they're doing. With me, when I'm doing a colonic, I try my best to make sure that I'm about strengthening the colon, making sure that it increases the peristalsis, rebuilding the brain and colon connection, because the colon is actually the second brain. It actually has more nerve fibers in it than in the actual cranial part of the brain. So the colonic helps to stimulate the peristalsis, which is the wave-like movement of the colon to push things through. So it actually strengthens the colon rather than break it down.
Oh, thank you so much. That was very informative. Now, bowel movements are said to be the basis of health. How many bowel movements should one produce on a daily basis, or does it vary from person to person?
Well, most people are used to going once a day, once every other day, and they consider it normal or normal for them. But if you're eating two meals a day, you should go to the bathroom two times a day. Three meals a day, you should go to the bathroom three times a day. Your body's able to take in the nutrients, digest it, absorb it, and eliminate the waste product. And a lot of us are taking it in, we're not even digesting it. And by not digesting it, we're not even able to absorb it. And so the stool sits in the system much longer than it needs to. And so that actually impedes the colon from going through that wave-like movement to get things moving.
Wow. That's definitely mind-blowing. Now, you just recently spoke about digestion. It is said that it begins in the mouth when one chews and swallows, and it is completed in the small intestines with the usage. Now, with the usage of colonics, can you determine if one has trouble with digestion? And if so, can colonics correct that digestive issue?
I mean, you can't tell to a point of, like, if you went and had a colonoscopy done or endoscopy done. But you can during a colonic. For instance, when I do a colonic, and the first thing I'm looking for is how much gas comes up. Is it a lot? Is it a little bit? I'm looking to see how long it takes for that water to turn from clear to brown. This tells me how hydrated the colon is or the stool is. I'm also looking to see when the stool comes out, what's the color of the stool? What's the consistency of the stool? Is there mucus in the stool? Is there undigested food in the stool? So if there's undigested food going through the tube of the colonic, then I know this person is not digesting their food properly. They're not absorbing their nutrients. And so there's some, their small intestine is not able to absorb, and their pancreas is weak. And so they're not being getting fortified with the food that they're taking, whether they're having organic or not. It doesn't matter because they're not getting the benefits of the food that they're taking in.
Now, you just spoke upon mucus. If there's a lot of mucus built up within a person's colon, is that something that can cause obstruction and delay the process of, having a bowel movement? Does that
Absolutely.
Also attribute to constipation?
Yes, it can. And the mucus comes from the type of food that we're eating. The person is eating. Are they eating mucus-laden foods, for example, dairy, bread? A lot of people think that whole wheat bread is great. I hate to say it. No, it's not. It has a lot of gluten in it. Mucus-forming food, pork, meat, all these things create mucus in your system, create inflammation. And the more inflammation the body has, the more the body tries to protect itself by releasing more mucus to help soothe the lining of the intestine. So you will have more mucus to tell me there's some kind of inflammation going on.
Yes. So is it something like the body will produce more like the mucus is somewhat like a protective barrier, are you saying?
Exactly.
Like a shield?
And what happens, that protective barrier, because we're keep constantly irritating. We're drinking coffee, we're drinking Coke or Diet Coke, all these things. Now that protective barrier becomes an enemy because now it becomes so much that it starts blocking. It gets kicked up against the sides, where it's slowing down the peristalsis, the movement of the colon, and so it's not able to do a full contraction. And by it not being a good full contraction, it cannot move the stool along, and so the stool sits in the body longer than it's supposed to, allowing more water to be reabsorbed, and the stool getting harder and staying there even longer than it's supposed to again, and creating all this extra heat or stagnant heat because of our body temperature at 98.6, we start basically cooking the stool, which makes it much hotter.
That is amazing. Now, you recently spoke about whole wheat bread and dairy, and speaking in terms of dairy might attribute to increasing more mucus in the body. What about one who starts to have like a more of a vegetarian experience where they're starting to purchase and consume more products that are gluten-free or yeast-free or wheat-free? Is that a better alternative? Is that something that might reduce the mucus levels within the body by starting to consume yeast-free breads? Is that something that's okay that might reduce
the
mucus levels?
That is the best thing that someone can do for themselves is getting off the dairy, getting off the wheat, the gluten. It says it right there in its name, gluten, glue. It creates glue. Gluten was actually put into foods back when there was so much starvation in Africa, and they were trying to, I guess, America or the world was trying to let them not feel like they were being hungry. So gluten was added to make them feel full. So gluten makes you feel full, like you just had a nice, solid, strong meal. But it had no nutritional value. It just bulks things up. And especially among the black community, it is the worst thing that you can happen to your system. And most people, when they, especially in the black community, not only the black community, but prevalently in the black community, has a very bad allergy to gluten. And I see it every day on how their body reacts and what goes on to them. And they're like, well, I've gained weight, or they look swollen. They don't look like they got fat. They look swollen, like you can take a pin and pop them. That's all that mucus, that's all that inflammation that's in the system that's clogging them up. And they're not able to create good bowel movement, create clean blood, because if the colon is dirty, then your blood's dirty, because the water that comes from, that makes your blood, actually comes from the colon. When the stool comes in, it's liquid at the ascending colon, and as it gets to the transverse colon, water is absorbed from the stool to make it more solid. And now the liver is supposed to take that water and clean it. But if you're drinking alcohol, you're drinking coffee, you're out late, you're smoking, you're doing all these things, your poor liver can't do the job that it's supposed to do efficiently. So now it's going to semi-clean this blood. And so now you have semi-clean blood feeding every single cell and organ of your body. Those toxins, or toxic material, I should say, that's in that blood is going to go to your weakest area. For some people, it might be their lung. For someone else, it might be their pancreas. Somebody else, it might be their kidney. Somebody else, it might be their brain. Whatever their weak genetic disposition is where those toxins are going to migrate to. You know, why are you going to fight someone that's stronger than you? You're going to go for the weakling. You know, that's why they have the whole bully thing going on.
Exactly. Only the strong survive.
That's right.
So is there a difference in the colon of a vegetarian as opposed to one that consumes meat? Can you tell which one is a vegetarian? Which person that might be a vegetarian as opposed to one who may consume meat? Can you distinguish by a person having a colonic?
Not really, because to be honest with you, most vegetarians are not true vegetarians, and they think because they don't eat meat, they're vegetarians, but all they're eating is junk. They're eating chocolate, they're eating Cheetos, they're eating everything that's not meat, but they're not eating fruits and vegetables. They're not eating raw. They're not eating living foods in their system. So, and they're eating a lot of soy, a lot of seitan, a lot of tempeh, and all these tofurkey. What is this stuff? I mean, that stuff is processed, genetically modified. I can't even call it food. I don't even know what word to call it. But 85% of the soy being grown today are genetically modified. Why would you want to put a genetically modified product into your body and do not expect that it's going to have a negative outcome? So when I look at a colonic, sometimes I can, if someone's eating healthily as a vegetarian, yes, they have a much better bowel movement. The stool comes out much easier. Their stools are nice and formed, about 10, 12 inches long. You know, they have a good contraction, everything like that. Some people who are eating a lot of dairy and meat and McDonald's, sometimes the water takes about 15, 20 minutes before it even turns color because they're so constipated. And when it comes out, their colonic's uncomfortable because all the toxic material is coming out, all the gas, with all the chemicals are in there. And so it takes them a little bit longer to get to that point. But it depends, on the type of vegetarian that they are. If they're eating the soy and stuff like that, it's just as if they ate the meat. A lot of people don't realize that soy has phytoestrogens in it, which are basically so much more estrogen and can act, have a contribution to estrogen-dominant breast cancer.
Mm, that's good to know. Now, you mentioned the best way, one of the best ways to remove some mucus from your body and toxins, maybe to remove dairy. Do you recommend rice milk or almond milk? What do you recommend in regards to a milk replacement, your dairy replacement?
Dairy replacement. I recommend, in the order of most nutritious, goat milk, raw goat milk. It's kind of hard to find these days. The goat milk chemistry is very close to mother's milk. The molecules are very, very, very similar. The chemical makeup, the bonding, the carbon bonds and so forth are very similar. So the body as a baby can recognize it. We are actually the only species that still drink milk after infancy. Everything else, every other animal in the world, wean itself off from infancy. We're the only one as adults still drinking milk. I don't understand it. But then if you want to go and drink milk, you have goat milk. You can use almond milk. You can use rice milk. You can use hemp milk. And those choices, and very easy to make your own almond milk. A lot of people would get the almond breeze. Into it from the time myself, before I got a little wiser, you know, I would go and get the almond breeze. It's just easy, quick for me to use. Until one day I decided to read the ingredients and it had carrageenan in it. Carrageenan is a thickening agent that actually causes ulcerative colitis and Crohn's. So it can, they can put in about 2% milk in there and the rest water, but if you add a carrageenan in there, it'll thicken and make you think you have all this wonderful milk. When you can make almond milk in your home in like 10 minutes.
I did that. I bought lots of almonds. It took a lot, but it definitely was worth it.
Well, one cup of almonds can, to 4 cups of water, 2 cups of almonds, I put it to like 6 cups of water, and you soak your nuts. And this is very important because people will say, I'm allergic to nuts. I get gaseous with nuts, or I can't do the almond milk. Because most of those milk, anyway, that is in the store, are not sprouted. The nuts are not sprouted. If the nuts are not sprouted, then they have these enzyme inhibitors on them. Let's use almonds as an example. They have the brown skin enzyme inhibitors. This has allowed them to be able to ship for a long period of time, also to protect the seed from just sprouting up wherever it wants to sprout up. So you need to sprout, soak them in water overnight and get all that stuff, and you'll see how the water changes. The next one, you rinse it off again. You rinse it off about 2-3 times to really get all those enzyme inhibitors out. The enzyme inhibitors destroy our digestive enzymes in our gut, which are supposed to be there to help digest your food. So if they're not present, then your body has to use more enzymes to help digest the food, and then you end up with all this gas, and you weaken your basically your enzyme bank account. So you make your almonds. You put it in, you know, a cup of almonds, 4 cups of filtered water. Put it in my Vitamix or a high-speed blender, you know, for a couple of seconds, and then you strain it into a cheese, like kind of like it's like a milk bag, like a nut bag that you can get from any health food store, and then you strain it, and then voila, you have your milk, your almond milk. If you want to sweeten it so the kids don't have sugar in there, you pour that milk back into the blender, you add some dates, some medjool dates, and then you sweeten it. Or you may want to make it more important to build the blood, so you soak a few goji berries, which helps to build blood. It's like a Chinese raisin. You add that to the milk. Now the milk looks like strawberries. So you can get to the kids and say, hey, here's your strawberry milk, because it looks orange. I mean, you know, pinkish. So you got, quote-unquote, strawberry almond milk. You want to make it a little festive for Thanksgiving. What I do is I tab the goji berries, and then I add a little bit of cinnamon, and it turns that milk into orange, and it looks like, you know, pumpkin, and so then I add a little bit of pumpkin spice, and it tastes like a pumpkin pie cake, you know. So there's different things you can do and be creative, and it will also give yourself a lot of nutrients. And, you know, goji berries is a superfood that really builds your blood, builds your chi, really, you know, you can do a lot with that and use it as a driving force to put these things into your body.
Wow, you are truly insightful. This is truly your forte. Now,
this is my
fiber, yes. Now, fiber is essential for producing good bowel movement. It can be found in apples, beans, and broccoli. What other sources of fiber do you recommend?
I like, sometimes I take psyllium. I find that psyllium sometimes can make people a little bloated. So I tell them to take apple pectin, oat fiber, or grounded flax seeds, you know. And, you know, get a coffee bean grinder, get the whole flax seeds, and grind them yourself. You know, instead of having them sitting there in the store for how long they've been processed. You know, get them, or you can use chia seeds. Chia seeds are amazing. It's mucilaginous. And you just add some water to it, and they get kind of jelly. You can add some almond milk to that and make that into a delicious pudding, and then you have amazing amounts of fiber. Dark green vegetables, your spinach, your kale, collards, all these things have amazing fiber in it. You know, your different fruits have fiber in it, and it helps. Fiber will actually pull the sugar and balance you, make a more of a sugar balance in your system. It will also help to pull cholesterol out of the colon and extract it out of the body. So fiber is very, very beneficial. I mean, I actually say you should have hope. Hope plus a couple other things. So hope stands for, H stands for high fiber, O stands for oil, P stands for probiotics, and E stands for enzymes. And then I add in the vitamins and the minerals, which is extremely important, minerals. None of that works if you do not have enough minerals into your body. Otherwise, your body will pull the minerals from your bones, from your
I'm
teeth,
sorry, say it again. The O stands for oils, the P stands for probiotics, the E stands for enzymes,
and the H
stands
for... So you got to hope. You got to need a little bit of hope.
What's the H stand for?
Hope vitamins and the minerals.
The H stands for?
High fiber. So you want to have high fiber. We're supposed to have at least 28 to 30 grams of fiber per day. Some people say 35 grams of fiber would be even more beneficial. You get that amount of fiber a day. And you cannot eat, like, you know, 20 apples. It's ridiculous. So you blend. You use it as a blend, and salad. You blend your fruits. You eat some fruits. You get the flax seeds. You put like a tablespoon in some water. You drink it, and you can get your 35 grams of fiber that way. So you have your high fiber. You have H. You have your O, which is the oils, omega-3, 6, and 9, which is the oils are very important for brain function, for the joints, for the heart, for the colon, lubricating the colon. The P is a probiotic. That's the good flora. That is what builds your immune system. And then you have the enzymes, which is necessary for any action in your body to be initiated. If you do not have enzymes, you cannot live. We're all born with a certain amount of enzymes in our system. Dr. Edward Howell talked about this in his book, Enzyme Nutrition. It's an amazing book. I think everyone should own this book. And he talks about how important, how your mom and dad, when you're conceived, you basically have a certain amount of enzymes. And you're supposed to go and quote unquote get a job or, you know, put more enzyme into it by eating properly, digesting your food. But when we're eating dead food, which is cooked food, then those foods are now void of enzymes. And if you're not taking digestive enzymes, you're not putting anything in. So you're just eating food that is dead and not giving any nutritional value. So you're using, you're taking out, you're withdrawing from your bank account every single day. Imagine if you did that for your own bank account with money and you never put anything in. So you're going to have a deficient bank account. It's the same thing going on with our bodies when we're eating cooked food and won't put anything raw in there. You're going to have a deficient enzyme account, and then your body starts pulling it from other places, robbing from Peter to Paul.
Yes, you know? Enzymes are necessary for all life forms.
Absolutely.
Now, one of the things that may break down those enzymes is sugar. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely, absolutely. Sugar is the devil. It creates insane acidity. It creates inflammation. It feeds cancer. It is the root of so many problems. ADD, ADHD, all these kids going to school on having to take Ritalin and all this stuff. You know, I had a patient many years ago, and they were going to put her 8-year-old son on Ritalin. And I'm like, because he said he's hyper. And I said, what do you have for breakfast? He has Cheerios with milk. He has orange juice. I give him some pancakes or some waffles. And then when he, on his way to school, he stops by Dunkin' Donuts and he gets some donuts. And then he'll get a coffee or he'll get a Coke. And this is before he even started school. So by the time he gets to class, how much sugar has he had in his system? How can he pay attention to the teacher? He's hyper. He's wired. That's a drug. Sugar is the most addictive drug there is. They even dip the ends of tobacco in sugar to make sure that every time you take a draw, you get that sugar in there. People are not just addicted to the tobacco, they're addicted to the sugar in the tobacco.
Now, currently in New York City, Mayor Bloomberg has plans to outlaw the sales of sodas larger than 16 ounces.
Sweet. I think it's the best thing he's done since he got into office.
Wow. Do you think that's something that's realistic? Do you think that's something that's realistic? For example, if you go to the movie theater and, you know, you're about to watch a two-hour or two-and-a-half-hour movie, and you're going to get your sodas or whatever have you, your beverages, and, you know, you want to purchase a super-sized 16-ounce. You think that's, or you can purchase, if he's going to outlaw 16 ounces of beverages, a person can just buy 2 8-ounces or three, and that would equate to more than 16 ounces. That'll be 24 ounces. So is that something that's, do you think that's realistic to say, well, he's going to outlaw purchasing beverages as large as 16 ounces? Do you think that's something that's realistic that he can actually put into effect?
I hope he's able to do it, and I hope people, instead of getting down and saying, oh, he's taking away our rights, sit and think about it. How many people have diabetes? How many kids are going to school now that are having adult diseases, that are having diabetes? It's because of these sodas. You go to this, do you really need 16-ounce or a 20-ounce Coke? When you look at that Coke, look at that Coke as a cup of acid that you're putting down your body. And you are slowly, slowly killing yourself. If you take that Coke and you heat it up, you can clean your pot. You don't need Brillo. There's an article that came out many years ago, I forgot what year it was, by the World Health Organization about Coke. And it said what they had shipped off Coke to the, I forgot which war, I think it was the Gulf War or something like that. Anyway, the trailers were sitting up in the heat for so long. And when they tested, when the soldiers went around to get finally getting to drink it because, you know, they couldn't get to it right away, with that heat in the desert, when they tested the Coke because they were started having neurological problems, it was because it was no longer Coke. It was changing to some other acid, and it's changing to formaldehyde. Formaldehyde is what they use to embalm you when you die. And then for formaldehyde, it changed into formic acid. So formic acid is basically when you have those red ants that bites you and it really stings. That's one of the things. Why do you want to put that into your body? Get over the fact that there's sugar and look at what it's doing to our system, what it's doing to our bodies. It's breaking us down. We're having premature aging, premature death. We should not be dying of having a kidney failure or going on hemodialysis. I have a cousin that's 45 years old on hemodialysis, and he has 30% of his kidneys because he has diabetes. Because he always goes to the store and get nachos with the cheese and his large thing of this. Honestly, we're in this world where we think large, bigger is greater and larger is better. You don't need to learn to conserve what you have. If you want to have a Coke here and there, okay, fine, you know, have it. But learn some self-control. Look at what you're putting into your body and what it's doing to you and what it's doing to you. It's dumbing us all down. It's dumbing our children down. You know, I look at it and say, wow, these are the kids that's going to end up taking care of me when I get older and running the office. I'm like, oh, yeah, yeah, this is not good. Because they can't think for themselves because they're on all this sugar and they don't understand what's going on. They're dumbed down with all the reality TV and all the commercials, and they think whatever they see on TV is gold, not realizing this is advertisement. Their goal is to make sure that you buy their product. That's their goal. And so I think he's doing a really good thing, and they should stop and think about it. You know what? Do I really need all of that? You know? How many medications are you taking? You know? How do you feel in the morning? Are you tired? Do you have headaches? Are you having field vision? All this comes from the things that we put into our mouth.
And our health is our wealth. Yes. So thank you so much. This was Miss Tracy Piper of the Piper Center for Internal Wellness. Thank you so much, Miss Tracy Piper. And thank you so much, Dr. Bay, for allowing this interview.
Oh, thank you all. Thank you all.
Thank
I mean,
you so much,
some,
Dr. Bay. I appreciate it.
No, appreciate
yeah,
you.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Excellent information. Excellent information.
Exactly.
Good night.
Good night,
good
y'all.
Night.
All right. We'll get back into this. Brother Mike, you know what we get ready
yeah.
to do. All right.
And it don't stop. And it don't stop.
Oh. Yo, we'll be dealing with the chai tai chi, so we're going to get back into that chai tai chi or qigong experience when we said you went through, Brother Mike, and we're going to bring Brother Karan, Dr. Karan, back in a few here. So go ahead on that experience, because I know that y'all got something from that last episode. I mean, Sister Deborah, what it was Dr. Pepper, and they dropped it, you know. So we're going to keep dropping it, you know. So give me some of that qigong.
Oh, okay, so, wow. I mean, you know, when we started taking, just going into the room, like I said, the atmosphere was so positive, and it was in a ballroom. And what the qigong master was saying, you're not in a ballroom. Even though, you know, this is a convention center in Austin, and you're not in a ballroom. This is a place for higher consciousness. This is just space where everybody is connected. So I wanted to go and say the stuff that we actually learned. So day one was called empowerment, right? So we started off with the opening, the theory of how qigong heals. Then we learned empty force. Then we learned breath empowerment. Then we learned cloud hands. Then after that, we learned earth hands. Then we learned around the world, push hands, Taoist yoga. And then there was a key animation. So during this whole thing, there was always an animation. You know, like in Dragon Ball, you know, whenever like Goku does a Kamehameha wave. Basically, like, that animation was always there, so the visualization was even more powerful. And so it started with day one was first empowerment, then day two was alchemy, so we learned food healing, qigong walking, nigong meditation, the five elements psychology, level two, the qigong theory, full body cleansing, drawing the bow, full body spiraling, and after that, so that was alchemy, right? Then day three, we had the healing circle, which was qigong strength training, Dan Tien, fine breathing. We learned the nine breath method, version A, B, the hands-on healing, which is where, you know, we send, you know, chi to loved ones and all around the world and people that need healing. We did the nine breath circle. And then on the last day, it was called Energy Peak. We learned the qigong practice, level three wuji style qigong, the seven wuji movements, group wuji experience. Then we learned the nine breath method, version C, and advanced version D. And then we close with the global healing meditation.
Man, you had 3 days of explosion, healing. You'll bring Brother Karan back in. Brother Karan, you back on?
This is me. Can you hear me?
All right. You got anything to add to Tai Chi or Qigong or any healing modality?
As a matter of fact, we are in the process of putting together a center, and the center is going to focus on some of the things I spoke about earlier in reference to creating that enclosed space. Tai Chi and Qigong are actually going to be utilized heavily at the center, especially in dealing with, you know, teaching our youth and getting them back aware of their responsibility to themselves, to their families, and to their communities. You know, we want to teach our young men how to be protectors of their in their community again, how to take care of their community. We can teach our young women how to be ladies again, how to be women again, how to be the earth deities that they are. You know, so we can get away from videos and movies and music, you know, negative music and stuff, teaching our children how they should present themselves in life, not having any care and any concerns or anything like that. So, you know, the whole concept of what Tai Chi and Qigong represents is really, you know, it really is an ancient science, because really the whole concept of Tai Chi and Qigong is almost, it's like movement in water, slow movement.
Exactly.
So you recognize the fact that as you are moving slow, you recognize that the air around you, you know, is a form of water, and you are tuning yourself in so much so sort of the point that you can actually feel the air as if it was water, which is actually a strengthening technique, and it strengthens you internally, and that internal strength radiates outward from within your being. So these are the principles that and the wild part about it is that this is what we practice historically. This is what we did, you know, and you know, when throughout history and with invasions and kidnappings and all that other stuff, we lost our sciences. These were our, you know, and it wasn't a big deal. It was like this is what we went out and just did every morning, or this is what we did. You know, these were the coming of age lessons that our children learned as they were coming into their manhood and their womanhood and so on and so forth. So it's like now we've come almost full circle. So there was a time, you know, maybe 20, 30, 40 years ago, somebody practicing Tai Chi and Qigong, they'd be like, man, you weirdo, man. Get out of here with that stuff, you know. And
yeah,
now all
exactly.
of a sudden, because of the damage that modern society has had on the vibration of the planet, now all of a sudden everybody is getting back, man, we got to get back in tune. We got to reconnect with nature. We got to reconnect with the universe, and we got to do all the different things. So, you know, it is making a very strong comeback, you know. And what we're doing with the center, the Kalu Center, we want to, you know, create an environment that starts with the garden, and we want to have an educational program for the children. We're going to have a cafe where it, you know, it's going to teach us how to, you know, get back into eating vibrationally, you know. We're going to have a dance studio for the young ladies, you know, and the young men who are into the dance, and so that they can tell the story of our elders within our community. That's something that's very important. We need to start to tell the story of, you know, of the elders within our community. Now, historically, we have stories that are widespread, but if you talk to any of the elders within your community, man, you'd be amazed at the things they've been through in their life, and that's the thing that we need to perpetuate. And we want to also have a martial arts aspect called the Temple of Kalu, and basically what that is we're going to pull the martial arts masters from within the community, no matter what your discipline is, and we're going to create a council, and within that council we're going to set up a temple, like the Shaolin Temple, where there's 19 chambers,
wow.
You'll have and the youth go through those chambers, and as they learn, they'll pick up the principles. They'll learn the principles of conditioning, the principles of discipline, the principles, but in addition to those things, they'll learn basic trades and things, because within their training, they'll be building an actual temple within their environment. So, you know, this is something that's going to allow us to go back into our communities and regentrify them from within, you know.
Right. Now Brother Karam, where is this temple or school, where is this going to be at? On what state
okay.
do you even know exactly where it's going to be? Because, you're making it sound so good. I'm getting ready to move.
We are actually in the process of going to start our first center in Virginia, in the Virginia Beach, Norfolk area, Chesapeake area, in that area of Virginia. But then eventually we want to begin setting up those centers around the country and ultimately globally. So the whole purpose of the center, and if anyone is interested in more information, you know, they can email me, and I'll send them, it's a video that I'll send you, a link to watch a video, and the video is going to explain a little bit more about the center and then how you can get, you know, become a part of it. Virginia is going to be our first site, official site, and then we're going to move from, you know, we're going to move from there.
Sounds good.
Sounds like Master Killer. 36 chambers, man.
I mean, and we want to do that because, you know, it's really hard to compete. And you know, when you want to do something for the youth, especially the teenagers, you know, it's hard to compete with what's out here already. You know, they got the internet, they got video games, they got the music videos and all of the stuff that our teenagers are into. So, it's you know, you got to really come, you got to come hard if you're going to do something that's going to catch their attention and stimulate them to want to, you know, to do better. So, you know, and at the same token, you want to make sure that the babies are taken care of because that's the most important aspect, you know.
Right.
The babies and then the elders. And then the elders, and in the process of doing all that, we're going to make sure we take care of our women, and we're going to make sure that our men, you know, are taken care of. And see, and we have to do this. We have to become responsible for our community again. We can't just say, well, I'm going to come to the community and I'm going to talk and drop some doctrine, some information on y'all, and then y'all buy my books, and then I'm out. You know what I'm saying? No, I got to come into the community and I got to be in there and I got to walk with you. I got to talk. We got to, you know, we got to struggle with each other. We got to, you know, learn what living of, for, and by each other really and truly means. We got to learn what love and unity really and truly means. And in doing that, we're going to reconnect ourselves with nature and reestablish that tonal unity. And by doing that, we're going to start to plant that seed. Nobody wants to plant a seed that's going to grow a tree that's going to have diseased or deformed fruits. So you want to make sure that the seed that you plant is the purest seed. You know, we have a lot of us have wonderful intentions. You know what I'm saying? But after that intention, if you get hit with so many distractions, it's easy for that intention to get warped and perverted. Next thing you know, you try and survive. So then all of a sudden, your pure intention has been turned into a hustle. Because, you know what I'm saying, now it's like the society that threw this wrench at you, and now like, man, I got to pay my bills, so now I got to hustle. Now I got, you know what I'm saying? So now it's taking the purity out of it, and that's exactly what society is designed to do. So in order to combat that, we have to create that pure place that society can't touch, and then that place exists for us to be able to go in and recharge. So when you go in this enclosed garden that we want to build, you can't talk. It's just you, nature, and the universe. So you go in there and you realign yourself and you retune yourself. And then when you come out, you carry that energy, and that energy begins to manifest bit by bit by the people who go into that garden and come out. And the next thing you know, the community begins to vibrate at the same frequency. The next thing you know, we're like, man, you know, we don't even need the police to come into our communities anymore. You know what I'm saying? We ain't even got to worry about nobody breaking into my houses. You got to worry about the children acting crazy. So, you know, everything is calmed down. And like the sister was explaining about how sugar is one of the most powerful drugs. You know, the teaching, learning how to eat right. You know, with the Kahlo Cafe we're going to set up. You know, we're going to show that it's not necessary to have. You know, you ain't got to have sugar every day. You know, I can vouch for that sugar thing because man, I stopped eating sugar for like a week. And I felt like a crackhead. I was hot, and then I was cold, I was shaking, my head was hurting, you know. And I was like, man, what's wrong with me? And then I ate a candy bar, and I was like, man, that was – and it scared me because I'm like, yo, you know what I'm saying? You could say what you want to about drug addicts and crackheads, but people who eat sugar, we the biggest drug heads.
Biggest drug heads.
Yeah, and it's taking its toll on us, you know, just genetically. You know, it's tearing us up. So we haven't given birth to babies who have these deficiencies and stuff that we've carried, you know, that we've inked into our DNA. Now they have it. So they're coming up and they're hyperactive and they're chemically imbalanced, which is a big thing. That's a big one. It's like there's a chemical imbalance that's happening in our children. So you got 8, 9 years old going to counselors for depression and stuff like that. And what is that? You know what I'm saying? So we want to create an environment so that we can reverse that. We don't even want to talk about we're tired of talking about the problem. We know that it's there. So instead of coming out and be like, yeah, and this happened to our babies, and this is what happened to our women, we're going to create an environment. Say, come into this environment so that we can reverse that. Come to a place where you can start to see your child, you know, through a process, you can start to see your child change and evolve and become an example of the supreme that's in their genetics already. You know what I'm saying? You hear a lot of people in the conscious community talking about the gods are being reincarnated through our children. Yeah, but if you take that child and you raise them around a bunch of beasts and demons and so on and so forth, where's the god going to come from? Who's going to train the god within them? So you see a lot of these children who are reincarnated supreme type beings, but the only environment that they've known is animal is the beast of the field. I could talk about, you know, in, you know, in the Bible, the beast of the field. It's, that's the only environment they've been in, so that's all they know. So they're very good at being beast of the field. They just, you know, even better than the other ones. You know what I'm saying? So it's like we have to create that environment that can groom that supreme being, that can groom that divine, that can groom those pharaohs and those rulers, those kings, you know what I'm saying, and those princesses and things like that. You know, I don't say queen because, you know, the language is jacked up and queen means whore, so we're not going to even say that. But we want to create that environment that's going to groom the best out of our children's genetics. And at the same time, while that's happening, the change that needs to be made in us, old crusty adults, you know what I'm saying? It'll happen, but it will happen. It'll happen gradually and passively, and that's what we need. We can't force ourselves into nothing. Because I'm too old to be talking about I'm gonna go in and join something and become a part. You know what I'm saying? It's, no, my time has passed on that. So if I can be exposed to an environment, like if I go to the library every day, you know what I'm saying? Eventually, my mindset is going to echo the vibrations in that library, just as if I go to a nightclub every night. My vibration is eventually going to echo the vibration of that nightclub. So if I go to and work out in the fields and plant and get my hands in the dirt and deal with nature and bring, you know, grow flowers and grow plants and grow fruits and grow vegetables and things like that, eventually my vibrations will mirror the environment that I'm around all the time. So we want to get into that. It's a very simple science, but it's a very high science. You know what I'm saying? And it's going to take, and all it takes is planting a seed. You know, my email is drkaram@yahoo.com. If you want to get some more information about that center, I'll send you a link. It'll be a video on there, and we can build from there. You know, but that's my little piece about Tai Chi and Qigong.
Okay. All right. Well, we got an event coming up in which that Brother Karam, if it's possible, you can definitely be a part of. It's our event. It's called the Healing Wings, Holistic Health and Wellspoke 2012, in which that we're going to be in Baltimore, Maryland, August the 3rd, 4th, and 5th. So we invite everyone to come on out during that time and support, you know, us in this endeavor. And you will be learning Tai Chi, Qigong, Reiki, Pranic Healing, which is pranayama, tantra kriya yoga, kundalini yoga, hatha yoga, many different forms of all energy modalities. And in other words, we're going to bring everyone into the fifth dimension, as we would say. So that event will be August the 3rd, 4th, and 5th, Healing Wings, Holistic Health, and Wellness Expo. All right, join us on that. You can go to Facebook, and you can see the flyer, or either y'all can email me at healingwingsonline@yahoo.com. That's H-E-A-L-I-N-G, wings, W-I-N-G-S, online, O-N-L-I-N-E, @yahoo.com. All right. My brother Karam, you want to drop anything else? You got plenty of time.
All right. Sure, I'll just drop a little bit about, I'm the founder of the Kalu Academy and Early Development Center, also the Kalu Foundation International and the Center for Human Spirituality. I'm the author of 19 books. The books are inspirational in nature or educational or books for children. A particular series I'm working on in reference to the books is called the Ankh Academy, which is my replacement for the Harry Potter books for our children. The book that I mentioned earlier, Shut the F Up, is one of the most. It's a small pamphlet, but it's really potent, and it actually is the catalyst for all of the things that we're doing. I got a website, www.kaluacademy.com. That's KALUAKADEMY.com. Kalu Academy, and again, my email is drkaram@yahoo.com. You want to get some more information, again, shoot me an email. I'm also on Facebook under Karam Ellis, and I actually have two Facebooks. One of them I tried to close, but it didn't work, so either one of them, Karam Ellis. Come on in, check me out. We'll be having some events and things that will be coming up as well up in the Virginia area, and as that information comes out, you know, we'll definitely keep you posted. And, you know, continue the wonderful work you're doing there, brother, Brother Bay, and you too there, Mike. And look forward
Appreciate it, again,
building with you all further and making that change, that global change that's going to make, you know, that's going to bring about the vibrational peace that this planet sorely needs.
No doubt. Appreciate you, brother. I'm glad that you came on, Dr. Karam, and we're going to have you on again here real soon. Because I know you got more to drop on it, so we'll have to bring you back over.
All right. Definitely.
All right, brother. Appreciate you.
Oh, no doubt. Peace, man.
You've been doing this hip-hop thing for years and years and years. You just, you know, embody it, and that's the key. You know what I'm saying? You don't have the love for it. Stop doing it. And right now, I'm not seeing love, you know, in anything in which that they're doing. Otherwise, I would be able to feel it, and I'm not feeling it, you know. Now, how that came about, South Shaolin, was because these were Brother True Master, you know, lead producer, you know, of Wu-Tang, and one of the founders of the Wu-Tang Clan. And, you know, we told him that, yo, you know, he was saying that he wanted to, you know, do some things here in the South. You know, and at that time, we had the Unclassified Element album out, which is called, and we named it the Shaolin, you know, Executor. You know, that's what Mike called it, and it was featuring me and different other brothers, you know, from Fayetteville, you know, North Kakalaka at the time. Even though we weren't all from there, that, you know, from Fayetteville, you know, we all came together there. And, you know, then we got, then I got up with my man from the Grave Diggers, you know, Fuquan Allah Bay, you know, and if y'all know who he is, I'm getting ready to play something for you so you can know who he is. He was a former member of the first hip hop band, Stetsasonic, you know, but he was with the Grave Diggers, with the River. I guess in a sense, I'm like unofficial slash member of the Wu-Tang Clan in a sense. So. You know, so that's what we've been
doing.
Oh,
yeah, definitely, Aline.
Right, right. So that's
what we've been doing.
Right, right. Appreciate that, Brother Mike. And so that's what we've been doing, y'all. And so, Brother Mike, again, closing words for the audience. Anything that you want to drop on them?
All right. I want to say this has been an awesome show. It's an honor to be, you know, on here. You know, just with everybody, especially you, Aline, because you were one of the teachers that, you know, I think always had confidence in my ability, you know, as far as hip-hop and spirituality and growth. You know what I mean? So what I wanted to do, I was wondering if I could just do a little, you know, just for hip hop, do just a little freestyle. You know, got some more joints coming. Do a little freestyle, and then maybe you can put on that Triumph song right after I'm done freestyle.
Okay.
Want to do it like that?
Oh yeah, do that, do the dad.
All right. You let me know when to go.
Oh, I'm ready. Hit it.
All right. Yeah. Adapt like aqua, be like water. Doesn't even matter who is hotter than Naga. Coming back with every rhyme, it's a mantra. Opening up every chakra. You ain't even ready as I open the gates, but I'm always ascending to the next level. I think I'm so sick like I sold my soul to the devil. Nah, I just made a bargain with the gods. And it doesn't even matter because they say it's a facade, but I'm going to keep on moving from the lightness to the dark, the creation. Doesn't even matter. Each hater is on that lower vibration. They ain't even ready to see the dedication for a better nation. I said that again, and I will do it without a shred of patience. But they better understand what I'm saying. They confusing the true God that is from the same that is with Satan. They gotta know. And before I rock the globe,
they better understand who is more intelligent. Send them to hell again. You know they don't have enough melanin, and I hit them with the frequency. It takes a lot to be an MC than just to say. A lot of people talk thinking they can't see, but they don't even understand what they're saying. I tell you, I'm not playing when I'm making these statements, and I'm taking all these racist faces and taking it away from enslavement, sees the hatred, peace, and love. Praise to the Most High and the One above. Peace.
Peace. That's why I come in like this, a battle-hardened veteran with an itchy finger, verbal assault weapon, your tongue's the trigger, blown the top, oblivious, ruined smithereens, nothing remains but atom molecules, body fragments scattered by shrapnel, ashes to ashes and dust to dust, the slaughters of mortars, mass confusion, and total chaos, the hands of grenades in the midst of waters, unleashing damage to winds and cyclones, fists running down, crushing cartilage of bones, carrying soon new flesh, casting souls in the abyss, return to the essence, a triple state darkness, 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 darkness.
Woo!
That's all for you rap battle niggas. You can't fuck with this.
It's the Illumination Show. If you wanna know, check the Illumination Show.
No doubt.
Yeah.
That's right. That was me on the lyrics, and that was my wife on the bars,
okay.
on the bridge. Yes, indeed. That's my sweetie. Not me. All right, no doubt. So, yo, y'all see, that's how we flow. You know, it's no, yeah, yo. Tell them,
if you don't know, now you know.
And if you don't know, now you know. That's right. So we can't really get up off of here acting crazy. But
just a little bit.
No doubt, no doubt. Just a little bit. All right? But we're going to see you on next Wednesday. I don't even know who we're going to have yet. We have so many offers this coming July. I mean, you don't know if we're going to have Phil Valentine. It's going to be A. Rashid. It's going to be Black Dot. We don't know, but stay tuned. All right? Peace.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
Get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday is 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.